cowboys for Jesus, working the range, spreading the gospel, we'll never complain. Though the days may grow long, we'll strive harder to be all the cowboys for Jesus should be. On the wide open prairie, through the day and the night, we'll carry the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Like the clear stars in heaven, or the desert so bright, we'll have a roundup with the gospel of light.
Are you glad to be alive in Jesus tonight? Amen. Well, I'm riding down the blacktop in my beat-up old truck, and I'm wondering why we're having such a run of bad luck. And then the Lord reminds me there ain't no such thing as luck, you see. Well, now God is in control and he's guiding you and me. And when I leave this old world of pain, you say a prayer over my final remains. Well, you can lay me in the dirt where the corn grows tall, 'cause it ain't gonna matter, I won't be there at all. Oh, I'll be crossing over Jordan, riding down the glory trail. Yes, I'll be crossing over Jordan, I'm free from life's travail. Now you can tell me you ain't never heard the Master's call. Well, now you're hell-bent for leather, but you're riding for a fall. So get up on that horse and start riding for the King. Oh, and someday on that glory trail, his praises will sing. And when I leave this old world of pain, you say a prayer for my final remains. Well, you can lay me in the dirt where the corn grows tall, 'cause it ain't gonna matter, around at all. Oh, I'll be crossing over Jordan, riding down the glory trail. Yes, I'll be crossing over Jordan, I'm free from life's travail. Oh, I'll be crossing over Jordan, riding down the glory trail. Yes, I'll be crossing over Jordan, life's travail. Feel so close to God outdoors as I sit right upon my horse. Hear the wind in the trees as I ride, just my horse and me. Hear the birds sing their song, all is at peace, nothing's wrong. It's the start of a brand new day. His still small voice, he leads the way. I see his wonder in the bright blue sky, the floating clouds as they pass me by. I feel his presence as he takes my hand and guides me to the promised land. Oh, I feel so close to God outdoors as I sit right upon my horse. Hear the wind in the trees as I ride, just my horse and me. Oh, another day I'll seek his will from the still of a canyon and yonder hill. Wildflowers bloom in every nook. Hear the babbling of a tiny brook. I see his wonder in the bright blue sky, the floating clouds as they pass me by. I feel his presence as he takes my hand and he guides me to the promised land. Oh, I feel so close to God outdoors as I sit right upon my horse. Hear the wind in the trees as I ride just my horse and me. As I ride just my horse and me. Thank you.
That same room up there, we have Ben's Bible study on Tuesday mornings. I'll get right in a minute. Tuesday mornings, it's 7 o'clock. So if you guys want to come out there and join us, we have a pretty good crowd most of the time and have a really good Bible study. Got a good teacher, good subject, so y'all are more than welcome to come. We want to thank the Mason family for allowing us to use these facilities. They're nice facilities, aren't they? Good seats. Yeah, give them a hand. Good seats, air conditioning, lights. I mean, it's just good. Good place to be. Next week, we'll have a young man we hadn't had in a while because he had something wrong with his throat, I believe it was. Anyway, David Shaw will be here next week, and I know y'all will enjoy him. It's been a while since we had him. Beta Gilbert, don't forget Beta. Beta's going home with us one of these days. I know she is. And Leon knows she is, and she knows she is, and you know, she's ready for the trip, and she's still pleasant and has a good attitude, and I think she just loves Rosie. I don't know that she cares for me much, but she just loves Rosie, and I don't quite understand that, but no, I do. But she's a blessing, and Leon, if you got anything else, you can tell us when you come around. George Payne, he's got a leg infection. He's over in Bass Pavilion. It looked horrible the other day when he was in the emergency room, to be honest. But hopefully they can clear that up. I believe she said it was clearing up. Rosie can tell you all about that. I'm not really sure on that one. But keep him in your prayers and her and the son in your prayers. We had a call earlier this week. Verlene Baker. Anybody know Verlene Baker? Well, I didn't know her either. But I got to know her real quick. She's a friend of a guy that comes here all the time. What was it? Robert who? Norman Yeager. Yeah, Norman Yeager. Y'all know Norman? He sits over here, got a flat top, big old boy. He lives up north somewhere. Anyway, he got to where he was bringing her here two or three times. And he called, was it Monday? Well, okay. That's close to Monday, isn't it? That's like a couple of days away. He called Friday and wanted us to come to the hospital because he was en route to the hospital with her. And we went to the hospital, and she was having a CAT scan on her head. And we went down and seen George, and then we come back up there. And she was out in the lobby. We sat down with her. And she looked at me, and she says, "Pastor, I got a question." Well, that's always good when somebody can, you know, ask you a question. And I said, "Well, what is it?" She said, "Well, I've been listening to you." And I said, "Well, thank you, Lord. Somebody's listening." She says, you keep saying that just baptism won't take you to heaven." I said, "Yeah, I've said that several times." I said, "Do you want me to say it again?" She said, "No, I've been listening." She said, "You know, I was baptized as a child, but I never was saved. And you say that you got to be saved to go to heaven." And I said, "Well, that's true. You must be saved to go to heaven. Baptism follows. That's just a show of obedience. But being saved will get you to heaven." And she says, "Well, I come to understand that, and I want to get saved." There you go. We led her to the Lord there in the waiting room, and they called her in about that time, and Unfortunately, she found out she had a brain tumor. Didn't have a clue she did. She just knew there was something in her head that wasn't right. So anyway, she's in the city in the morning at 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock. Well, it's close. She's going to have surgery. We'll be down there. I don't. Rosie keeps me in line where I'm supposed to be, so we'll be down there. But y'all just pray for that lady and pray for the surgery, that she'll come through it all right. And I look forward to putting her in the tub over here. And I told her, no, we'll follow that with baptism, just like we do with everybody else. You know, the Lord asked us to do that just as obedience. But baptism will not get you to heaven. Amen?
Amen.
Salvation will get you to heaven. Okay? Don't ever forget that. Like I said, I was just tickled to death that lady said, well, I've been listening to you, and here. Well, that's good. That's what it's about, isn't it? For us to give the word and for them to accept it. And that's what it's all about. Okay, I got off a little bit. Prayer requests, praise reports, birthdays, anniversaries, something that we need to know about.
I'm going to have surgery on my nose again. And I'm also doing other tests on my kidney and some spots that I have on my brain. So in the next 6 weeks or so, just remember me in prayer. Yes, I still go to dialysis 3 days a week.
I've got a 14-year-old great-granddaughter that's going to have neck surgery and a bone graft about a week from now. But we certainly need prayers for her, because this will be the second time for her on that procedure. So, thank you.
Please pray for Brooke Langley, the little Wranglers teacher. She's got West Nile.
Yes.
Father, we come to you this day thanking you, Lord, for the day and for the ones that turned out to hear your word. Lord, be especially with Terry and Rosie as they lead. And Father, I can't praise your name enough how you take care of us. Just have it each one of us where you need us. And we pray for the ones on our prayer list, Lord. We know that you are the great physician and you can heal if it be your holy will. And Lord, we ask for that healing wherever it's needed. And Father, I can't praise you enough for this nation and the freedom we have.
Yes.
Oh, Father, preserve it if it be your will. We thank you for taking care of us like you do. And we thank you for what Christ done for us at Calvary. And we can't praise you enough for that. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
He loves us. And I'm glad the blood is still there. Even when I fall, that blood is covered, and he loves me, and he's going to pick us up and carry us, and he's always there. The blood is still there. One dark night in Egypt, a fearful time had come. For one little Hebrew boy who was his father's firstborn son. The angel of death was passing low. It was hard to fall asleep. But one little lamb stood in his mind as he lay there counting sheep. He wondered why that young lamb had to die, why his blood was on the door. Through the wind and rain, it had still remained, but he wanted to be sure. So he called out to his earthly father with a trembling voice so scared, saying, Father, will you please look and see if the blood is still there. And he said, Son, now don't you worry, for the blood is there to stay. The wind may blow and the rain may fall, but it won't just wash away. The blood will stand the rain. It's been applied with loving care. Safe, secured, you can rest assured that the blood is still there.
looking over the damage Satan's storms had left behind. The flood of endless questions and doubt had filled my mind. But the fear that gripped my troubled soul brought me back to my knees in prayer. Say, Father, will you please look and see if the blood is still there? And he said, child, now don't you worry, for the blood is there to stay. The wind may blow and the rain may fall, but it won't just wash away. The blood will stand the raging storm. It's been applied with loving care. Safe, secured, you can rest assured that the blood is still there. Oh, safe, secured, you can rest assured that the blood.
Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2, that's an Old Testament. That's where we're going to start out. Joel chapter 2, beginning verse number 30. It says, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in the Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. That's a powerful text right there. Very powerful text. I believe the state of the affairs of the in the Old Testament text of Joel there, if I just... If you go over and read the whole thing of Joel, was a whole lot like we are here in America. Some of the same problems. It is in the last days, and God's grace is still the only guaranteed answer for our homes, our families, our churches, our nation, and the world. God is our only hope. There is no other. And almost all of us have probably noticed that some folks do not listen real good. Anybody ever notice that? I found out a long time ago, a lot of folks don't listen real good. Or they don't listen as good as they should. Y'all know I was a police officer all my life, and that's, you run across people that just, huh? That's about all you get out of them for a while. But a lot of people don't listen. So like we do with our children and sometimes other folks, when we're speaking to them, we sometimes have to repeat things to get their attention, don't we? And that's okay. Until it's over and over and over and over again, you say, what did I say? Y'all been there, I know you have. God loves us so much that he sometimes repents himself so that we might wake up and get to what he is really wanting us to hear. Sometimes we just kind of let it blow by. We just kind of ignore it, and he'll repeat it to us. And we'll just kind of ignore it. Acts chapter 2, New Testament, verse 16. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. That's what we just read. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith the Lord, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. But don't leave anybody out, does it? Upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. I'm getting in that category, I guess, dreaming dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth below, beneath, blood and fire and vapor and smoke, And the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood. But that great and notable day of the Lord come, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So we got it in the Old Testament. We've got it in the New Testament. Like the prophecy that we read of Joel, men were evil back then. Real evil. Just like they are today. Some things never change, do they? There's a lot of evil folks in today's world. They run as fast as they can run to the bandwagon of trouble. But that is a choice that they make. We have a choice. We can make our own decisions. And they make that choice. They invade and devastate the land, take the lives of citizens, take the lives of our police officers nowadays, the lives of our innocent little babies that never even get to be born. Think about what where we're at. Those that try to keep the peace, they're just trampled down. And the lives of the unborn babies and everyone in between those. Our young and innocent are solid like pieces of property. They're sold like pieces of property. I'm not even going to go there. You know as much about it as, well, maybe not as much as I've heard, but the young and innocent are sold like pieces of property for the perverted pleasures of ungodly, corrupt men and women. All over our nation, our babies are being wasted because somebody wants just to have a little bit of what they call pleasure. I personally think I could give them some pleasure, but they probably wouldn't like it. Psalms chapter 10, verse number 4 says, "The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all their thoughts." The wicked invade and destroy and tear down historical buildings, biblical landmarks, and truths that have declared to the world who America is. They're taking all of our history out. Well, somebody did something bad in the history of it. Get real. What if somebody come and tore your house down and said, "Well, you know, there's a bad history in that house, so we're going to tear it down"? Folks say that America is not a Christian nation. I'm not arguing one way about that. It may not be. But one thing nobody can deny, it was built on Christian morals, values, and truths. That's what our country was built on, folks. Look what we've done with it. Just like the rest of the world has a choice in this great country we call home, we all have a choice. You listening to me? We all have a choice. The right to be a Christian or the right not to be a Christian. And we each and every one of us has that choice. That is a choice we all make on our own. And I've heard lots of folks say, "I do not have to make a choice." You know what I tell them? You just did. You just did. That's what it would be like running up to a red light and saying, "Well, I don't have to make a choice whether to stop or not." If you run the red light, you made a choice. Bad choice. If you stop at the red light, you made a choice. A good choice. Either way, you made a choice. People don't realize when you make a decision to do something, that's your choice. Nobody's but yours. You can't blame somebody for it. Somebody says, "Well, do this or do that." It's still your choice. It's not theirs, it's yours. We all have choices. We all have choices one way or the other about Christ. Do we love him or do we not? It's your choice, isn't it? I can speak mainly about the things that happen here in America because other than in the military, I never have been out of America. I've always been in America. I've spent quite a bit of time overseas in the military, but other than that, I've always been in America. And because of what I have visually seen and heard about in this country, it's devastating. For a country that we live in, a free country, America, and look where we're at, look where we're headed. Listen to the news. We have allowed our country, which I always call the Garden of Eden. This is our Garden of Eden right here, America.
But, you know, look what we're doing to it. You get quiet on me, but folks, we're doing bad things to it. Not only to America, but to each other. Remember what God said in Joel 2:32, and it shall come to pass. If God said it's going to come to pass, it's going to come to pass. There's no question about it. That whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Has everybody in here done that? You know another thing this lady told me the other day at the hospital? She said, I heard you when you said, I think I'll just, every time I shake somebody's hand, I'm going to ask them if they're saved. She said, I want to be sure to be saved. I said, well, that's a good idea. And then I thought, well, you know, maybe that was a good idea. I did that over a person that died, and I wasn't sure whether he was saved. And I started asking his friends whether he was saved or not. And then one of them really didn't know, and I looked at him. I said, well, have you been saved? No. You know what? He got saved sitting right there where you're at, brother. Now, we need to be bold enough to ask somebody if they're saved. Do you know the Lord? What can I talk to you about him? You don't force yourself on him. Just say, can I talk to you about him? You know what? Most of them will do it. They're getting to where most of them are like, get out of my face and walk off. You know, that's just the typical thing. But Acts 2:21, I've got these two verses in here three times because I want you to understand Acts 2:21, New Testament. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Same thing I talked to that lady at the hospital the other day. You can be saved right here. You don't have to go to church to be saved. Wherever you're at, you can be saved. You ask the Lord to save you, and he will do that. If you need some help, you call me. Call Rosie. We will be glad to help you. Show you what you need to do. Remember, God often repeats his word and emphasizes it to get the point across, just like we do. Just like we're talking to our children, and you know they're not understanding you. You may say it a time or two, and maybe another time or two, but you always tell them this is what's going on. That's what God does. He tries to get our point. As in the days of Joel and in the days of Peter and the days of Pentecost, people are still lost and still searching. They're all over. And every time I run across one, it just amazes me how many people that's really not saved that sit in churches. I don't know how many in this church right here may not be saved. I'm glad you come. I really am. If you're not saved, let me know it. I will sit down with the Bible. We'll just go through the scriptures. You say, ah, that ain't for me. That's your choice. See, we all make choices in life. Some we make are good. Some we make are bad. And I may look at you and say, well, that's a bad choice, but it's your choice. So always remember that. For many years, our country was basically open to the Lord and his message. You know, in the early years, just remember 40, 50, 60 years ago, and gospel was running all over this land. Lots of folks was getting saved. Folks, it's not that way anymore. Now, as in the days of Joel and Peter, you know, and Pentecost, hey, that was really, I guess, all they had to talk about. I don't know what they would have had to talk about back then. Anybody been? No, y'all wasn't back there, I know. Let's just forget that one. For many years, our country was basically open to the Lord and his message, but now the devil and his crew seem to be working as hard as they can possibly work, destroying our country. And we're sitting back letting them do it. Well, I don't want to say nothing. I don't mind saying something. Christ is real. The devil is a liar. And we need to look him in the face and tell him that if that's it. But listen to the promise of Israel as predicted by Moses. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1 and 2 says, and it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I have commanded thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, that if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Folks, are we still going to have troubles, trials, and tribulations even as a Christian? We are. Let's be honest with it. We're humans. We live in this earth and in this world, and we're part of it. But we don't have to let them stomp on us. I just have never been somebody to let anybody stomp on me. And I don't expect I probably ever will be. But I love God, and if I get a chance to tell somebody about God, I'm going to tell them about it. He says, well, I don't want to hear. I said, sorry, brother, and I'll turn around and walk off. That's, you know, we don't create problems about it. We just say, hey, I'm a Christian. Could I talk to you about that? And I say, no. Just say, I'm sorry, and turn around and walk off. Don't say you're sorry. Just say, okay, and turn around and walk off. And most of our history of our country, our leaders hearken to the voice of the Lord. And God has blessed this country tremendously. Ever since he's been in existence, he's blessed it tremendously. But over the past few years, we've seen tremendous declines in the number of folks that claim to be Christians. Why is that? Are we not doing our job? I know I don't do my job well enough. Otherwise, we'd have more people being saved. I'll take the blame. But you have to be willing to witness also. At the same time, we've seen tremendous declines in our academic achievements in this country. We're not near as sharp as we used to be. Look at our schools, the people in our schools. Look what they're doing to our schools. People want to go around and kill everybody nowadays. I don't understand it. I don't know what it's all about. It's the devil. I can tell you what it's all about. He is the one that just ruins everything. A lot of folks, individually and as a nation, seem to be trying to destroy or do away with or just trying to forget all the things that God has asked us to do. We seem to know what they are anymore. They're in your book. Everybody got a book? They're in there. If you'll pick it up every now and then and look at it, you'll see that there's a Old Testament, a New Testament, and a lot of good stuff in there. This is God's book to us as Christians. You know what? It's now legal for us Americans to kill our own babies. Can you imagine that? We abort babies before they ever even get a breath of air. Do you realize that we can get stoned out of our mind now? Smoking our little marijuana and all that stuff is legal now. You say it's medical marijuana. Well, where do you get their prescription at? I don't know. I'm a little confused about some of them things. It seems like that God, when God says that we need to do this and this and this and I'll bless you, we kind of turn around and run the other way now. Like as if we don't want a blessing. Folks, you think I'm just making this up? I'm really not. It's real. We're not doing what we're supposed to be doing as Christians. I'm not doing as much as I should be doing as a Christian. And I'm freely willing to admit it. I want to tell you what I hope you already know. Sin is still sin. It hasn't changed. It's still in the book. If God said don't do it, it's exactly what he meant. Don't do it. He hasn't changed his mind. If God said do something, he meant it. He don't change his mind. James chapter 1 verse 22 says, be ye doers of the word. That means obey the word. Do what the word asks us to do. Not hearers only. You're listening to me now, but go read your book and see if it doesn't say the same thing I'm just telling you. I'm reading a lot of this out of the book. I write it on a piece of paper because it's easier than swapping, running through a Bible right quick. What a difference God can make even in the worst of things. He's the best. It's really that simple. Salvation, I'm sure you've probably heard this many, many times. God's amazing grace is still our only guaranteed insurance policy. He's our only hope. There is no other hope. It covers the storms that we've been in. Covers the storms we're fixing to be in and the storms we're currently in. It covers them all. Jesus Christ is there. If we belong to him, he's our Father. He said, I'll help you with that. Remember what God said in Joel 2:32, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Acts 2:21. Y'all know what it says too, don't you? That person says delivered. Now, delivered and saved, it means the same thing. The Old Testament says delivered and the New Testament says saved. The Lord's going to deliver you out of sin. So it's the same thing as saved. Acts 2:21 says, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God hasn't changed that. It's still right there. You say, well, I need help. Well, call on him. He'll talk to you. I want you to remember that you and God crossed through centuries. Look what you've been through as a Christian. Look what we've been through. Look what our country has been through. And you say, well, it's not a Christian nation. Well, it was founded on Christian values. No doubt about that whatsoever. Romans 10, 12 and 14 says, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. We holler, well, that guy's not quite like me. I don't want him in church with me. Let me read that again. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. How dare you say, well, he's a little different than I am. Guess what? He's looking at you saying, you're a whole lot different than I am. We can't do that. That's not what it's about. Romans 10:14 says, and how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Well, folks, you got one standing in front of you. God called me to preach, and I'm telling you what the Word says. If you want to question it, I'd be glad to talk. I'd be glad to sit down and talk with you this evening for however long you want to talk. As a God-called preacher, it is my responsibility to tell you who Christ is and what he wants. Amen? When you've heard the Word, guess what? You are responsible for it. I've given it to you. Would I be glad to sit down and talk with you more about it? You bet I would. I'd love to. Just like the lady at the hospital, I was just like the guy who led the Lord right here. I asked him just flat out, well, are you saved? No. Huh? He said, well, just never have. But you know, it just astonishes me how many people are really that way. But you know what? I love it when they say, hey, preacher, I need to get saved. Because that's what we need to do. I'll say, okay, let's sit down here and just talk about it a minute. That's what I did with Hurt's Hospital. Okay, well, let's sit here in a minute and talk. You know, that's, Rose and I both were sitting there. We were just having a blast. We'd seen her here several times, didn't really know her. It is Christ's desire that when you hear the Word, you will believe on him and be saved. But you know what? He will not force you to do it. If you don't want to be saved, he says, adios, I love you still. That's what it's all about. After hearing that, I would hope that you would believe on him and ask how you can be saved if you're not saved. Because I will be glad to tell you. There's a lot of people sitting in this room would be glad to tell you. I'll be honest with you. I would really hate for anybody I've ever preached to go to hell. You know why? Because I would feel like I didn't do what I was supposed to be doing. And sometimes I certainly feel that way. Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Folks, that is only one way. There is no other way to get saved. That's through Jesus Christ. Romans 10:10 says, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. You simply ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, clean it out, save you. And he will do that. He does not hesitate. He doesn't ask you a whole lot of questions like I might. He just says, if you want to be saved, you're saved. It's really that simple. You say, well, it's not that simple. Yeah, it is. Give it a try. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your Word. Lord, you've told us it's sharper than a powerful and two-edged sword. Lord, I just ask you to let your Word stick in somebody's heart tonight. Let them know that they're not saved and that they need to come to be saved, dear Lord. Wherever they may be, on TV or on the internet or here, wherever they may be, that they'll just get get down on their knees and ask you to save them. Or ask somebody, well, tell me a little more about that. Father, we just ask you to bless the rest of this service. Bless Barry as he sings for us. In Jesus' name we ask this. Amen.
That's called preaching, huh? Amen. Yeah. A crown of thorns they put on his head. They drove nails in his hands and his feet. They cursed his name and they mocked our precious Savior. But willingly he gave it all for you and me. Oh, I wonder what he was thinking when they laid him down. Oh, did he cry out in pain when they drove those nails? And how deep did those thorns pierce his brow? Oh, but through it all, he knew the time was now. Yes, Jesus gave it all for you and me. He shed his blood Calvary. He bled and died for the sins of this lost world. Yes, Jesus gave it all for you and me. Oh, the pain he must have felt as he hung there. Oh, his heart must have broken in two. But he never called down any angel to stop the sacrifice he knew that he must do. Can you sing that chorus? Jesus gave it all for you and me. With me, I love that. Oh, Jesus gave it all for you and me. He shed his blood upon a cross on Calvary. He bled and died for the sins of this lost world. Yes, Jesus gave it all for you and me. Now picture your own son hanging on that cross. Oh, with nails being driven through his hands. Now your son's bleeding and he's dying. This lost old wicked world. Oh, I wonder, could you let it be? Yes, Jesus gave it all for you and me. He shed his blood upon a cross on Calvary. Bled and died for the sins of this lost world. Yes, Jesus gave it all for you and me. The blood is still there. What a great song you sang, Rosie. Great song. Well, up in northern Colorado where the canyons run so deep, someday I'm gonna ride. Oh, down in the bottom where the water, its secrets it keeps, and someday I'm gonna ride. Well, up in Wyoming where the wind always blows, someday I'm gonna ride. Oh, you'll find me north of Medicine Bow, and someday I'm gonna ride. Oh, when my horses are running wild and free, my soul from this body leaves, I'm gonna ride eternally. Well, now you don't know who I am and don't know my name, don't know where I'm from, where I might have came. Oh, you don't know me, but you judge me the same. But someday I'm gonna ride. Well, out in western Oklahoma where the red carpet lies, someday I'm gonna ride. And when that wind is blowing, that dust gets in your eyes, and someday I'm gonna ride. Well, up in Minnesota where the winters you learn to hate, someday I'm gonna ride. And will my bones ache when it's minus 38? Someday I'm gonna ride. Oh, and my horses are running wild and free, my soul from this body leaves, I'm gonna ride eternally. Well, now you don't know who I am, and you don't know my name, don't know where I'm from, where I might have came. Oh, you don't know me, but you judge me the same. But someday I'm gonna ride. Ha! I was in the Cimarron River on a horse in the Oklahoma Panhandle just outside of Forgan, Oklahoma on the Adams Ranch, and was helping them. I had 500 pair, and we had to push them all into one spot of the river because the tamaracks had taken it. And God was asking me to do something that I told him I wouldn't do. Leave a fourth-generation farm cattle operation and start doing what we're doing now. I'm pretty good arguing with God, but I've never won yet. So anybody here won that argument ever? Yeah, not going to win it. And as I was in the middle of that river, I could smell the horse. I could hear the cattle splashing. I could hear the guys yelling. I could hear birds singing. It's like it became a spiritual thing. And as we went up the other side of that river, up into the first trap, I didn't know that in just a few weeks I'd be in the jungles of Cameroon, Africa, doing 8 concerts in 5 locations. Changed my life. See, I was telling people a lie, that I was serving him 100% and I wouldn't. But after that event, that's my prayer. I'm riding along the Cimarron, the world seems far away. Nature's critters talking, I hear every word they say. Past that old fallen cottonwood and the smell of the sage and the tall grass waves to me as if to say, What if tomorrow it's your last ride? Oh, then I'll just thank him for riding by my side. 'Cause I'm riding along the Cimarron. I hold the reins in my hands, and the birds sing a pretty tune that I understand. We pull up to a cedar, hear the sounds of the creek, and we stand in silence as he begins to speak. What if tomorrow it's your last ride? Oh, then I'll just thank him for riding by my side. And if tomorrow finds me on a range unknown by man, oh, I'll be there with a smile on my face as I ride in his amazing grace. Oh, I'm riding along the Cimarron. The world seems far away. What a wonderful day. We'll close this out. This needs to be our prayer, I think. And I just feel that leading. This should be our prayer every day. It should be incorporated in our prayers. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home. What a great country we live in. Thank you for pointing it out. Guys, please be seated. I have to close. Everybody sings this song, and I know that. But God has told me that I'm supposed to close everything I do with this song, and I don't know why. Man, there's the only answer is Jesus to all the problems we have. Thank you for being bold and for challenging us to ask people. That's one of my weak points. I need to do that. Thank you for challenging me. I, in awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I can see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Let him hear you, would you? Then sings my soul, my God, his son not sparing, he sent him to die. I scarce can take it in. Oh, upon that cross, my burdens gladly bearing. Oh, he bled and he died just to take away my sin. We sing this a lot as Christians. But how great is our God? He's great enough that when I'm down, he never forsakes me. He's there. So let's sing it to him, our loving God.